and welcome. My name is David Berry, and I'm the Artistic Director of the Shenandoah Valley Bach Festival. This is our Leipzig service, and every year our festival ends with this service. It's a particularly special service today because we're pleased to welcome many of you who may be here for the first time. Thank you for all of you who are brothers and sisters from local congregations, as well as from the global Mennonite Peacebuilding Conference here with us today. I know this has been a beautiful and full week for many of us, and so I'm delighted that we can all worship here together today. Our conductor for today is Dr. Benjamin Bergey, and he's going to say a few words about today's service.
Thank you, David. Well, it's my pleasure to welcome you to this worship service, loosely modeled after a service that would have occurred during Bach's time as cantor at the Thomaskirche in Leipzig, Germany, hence the name Leipzig Service. The cantata this morning is a festive one that Bach wrote for a new year, praising God for the previous year and praying for hope and peace in the next. Before I offer a few details about this morning's service, I wanted to acknowledge and introduce a bit more of who all is in this space this morning. This service is the annual closing event of the Shenandoah Valley Bach Festival, now closing its 31st season. It's also the closing event for the third Global Mennonite Peacebuilding Conference and Festival, which has been meeting on campus since Thursday. This peace conference has participants from 24 countries under the theme of Coming Together, the Journey of Faith and Peace. There are also many community members present, especially from several area churches that have invited their congregants to attend here this morning. So whatever brought you here, you are welcome here. We are glad you are here, and together we will create a rich and diverse tapestry that won't happen in the exact way again. And it's a fitting theme for this morning of joy and praise for this year, our next opus, and God's presence among us as we seek peace and pursue it. So I invite you to enter into this morning as fully as you wish. We will follow the order of service without introductions to each item, so please follow along. It can be found either in the printed bulletin that you received on the way in or beginning on page 51 of your Bach Festival program book. There are a few details that I'd like to mention to help make your trip through the liturgy a bit smoother. First of all, I invite you to turn off your cell phones. Second, VT is an abbreviation for Voices Together, which is the purple hymnal in the pew in front of you. I'll invite you to stand, if able, for almost every hymn. The second hymn, Holy God, We Praise Your Name, has multiple languages printed. Feel free to sing the language of your choice. At the same time, God will understand. And that song will actually start with the prelude, so the organ prelude will happen prior to singing it. Andrew Suderman will read scripture. The salutation and collect will be led by Les Helmuth, and you may respond and chant with the bold lines, singing the underlined syllable a third lower. Da 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 da. If you've not been here before, feel free to listen to the first one to see how it goes. Following the cantata, we will respond with the third verse of Now Thank We All Our God, and since not everyone has the same version, we will actually all sing from the blue hymnal, number 86, but I'll remind you of that one at the time. And I'll briefly introduce our homilist for this morning. Shannon Dycus, Vice President and Dean of Students here at EMU, leads the Student Life Division of Eastern Mennonite University. She holds a degree in secondary education from Butler University and received her Master of Divinity from Christian Theological Seminary. With passion for holistically journeying with people, Shannon is also a trained spiritual director through San Francisco Theological Seminary. Shannon is active in writing and worship development roles within Mennonite Church USA, publishing the 2019 Women's Bible Study titled Every Time I Feel the Spirit with Herald Press. We are grateful to have her here this morning with us to bring us the message. So once again, welcome. May we together find hope and peace in Christ, and through worship and singing together, praise God for that which has come before us and that which lies ahead of us. Following tuning of the orchestra, I turn it over to Marvin Mills as we prepare for worship.
On the first day of the feast of the unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying to him, "Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?" And he said, "Go into the city to a certain man and say to him,
The teacher says, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples. So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. Now when evening had come, he sat down with the 12. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives.
Praises, all our hearts are filled with gladness. Hallelujah, we sing your praises, all our hearts are filled with gladness. unsere Ruhe will verstören. Soll wolltest du, o Herr, Gott erhören, wenn wir in heiliger Gemeinde bieten. So bleiben wir zu deinem Ruhm, dein auserwähltes Eigentum, und können auch nach Kreuz und Weiden zur Herrlichkeit von hinnen scheiden.
Number 86, verse 3.
leadership role in this community that has been honored to host each of you today or this week, I offer greetings and welcome. On behalf of President Huxman and Provost Niss, the incredible staff, and the committed students of EMU, it's wonderful to have you here. To my dear colleagues, Andrew Suderman, Benjamin Bergey, David Berry, who somehow got me here speaking these words. Thank you, I think. Genuinely, thank you for the wild visions that each of you carry and the passion that you breathe into them. We are blessed by your gifts and your courage. Friends, joined in this room and those who are virtual, what a bounty of gifts we have been able to receive, right? This day, for some of you, is day 8 of melodies and beauty of song that we have enjoyed from the Shenandoah Valley Bach Festival. Memorable classics, heroic symphonies, jazz legends weaved together, and identities of composers and wonderfully gifted musicians, what gifts we have held. Leaders from Mennonite World Conference started gathering earlier in the week with planning and prayers for the work of our global church. As that grew into a larger conference of Mennonite peacebuilding, the theology, the practice, the witness of God's peace in our world. What I took in was prophetic expressions of how peace is imagined or being made known all around the world. And then many more are gathered here this morning from our local congregations, honoring the presence of God that is flowing in this space today. What gifts we hold. We talk frequently here at EMU about the intersection of music and peace building, the way that power and creativity work together in transformative ways. This week, today, we have put theory into practice. In one of the midday concerts this week, a piano, a cello, and a violin created these sultry rhythms of Cuban jazz music from a composer, D. Rivera. It was a celebration that flowed. It was energy that invited. My hips wanted to move in the midst of it. The music required good dancing. I tapped my foot and nodded my head like a good Mennonite. But I wanted to offer a response back to what they gave. Within the Peacebuilding Conference, an afternoon paper presentation around Anabaptism and liberation theologies offered perspectives and practice, challenging us to consider what attention to shared needs means when one member in our community is suffering and we treat them as different instead of joining them in their suffering. We all left reflective. Wherever you have gotten to connect this week, you too may be carrying stories of provoking thought or compelling melodies. We leave here with gifts, gifts of ideas, of connection, of inspiration. But what makes these gifts powerful is that these are not just gifts that we admire or observe or simply consume. We've been impacted, moved, maybe even changed. These gifts have touched us in our minds and our spirits, found places of rest or dissonance in our bodies. Like a feast we can imagine on Thanksgiving Day, we have eaten, found pleasure, wanted more, and become full. What a bounty of gifts. We haven't just listened to lectures or presentations, enjoyed performances or concerts. Expressions of real hope have invoked an exchange. An exchange where we are all moved and engaged in conversation. What a powerful celebration of what God can do held in this room. So in the tradition that I am from, somebody would have said amen right there. And I want to invite us to a little bit of expression from what I know and allow us a bit of permission. Celebration from what we've heard this morning and what we have known this week in every part of our lives shows up in our bodies and it gets echoed in our voices. For the work of God and our siblings to coordinate the blessings of this week, we get to say amen. Yes. We have permission to celebrate with our hands and our feet and our voices. You can even move your hips if you feel like it. But for the hours of study that have shown up in gifted musicians and thoughtful theologians, we are grateful and we say amen. Because we know better than to take for granted what it means to travel and share living space and be in communal worship. And so we say amen. Amen. For the divine wisdom that imagined this celebration years and months and weeks ago, we are grateful and we say amen. Amen. Pray with me. We have come this far by faith, O God, leaning on your love. We're trusting in your holy word. You haven't failed us yet. We come to this moment with faith. Amen. As a young girl, I grew up in Chicago, surrounded by lots of family and people I love like family. My grandfather was the pastor of the church we attended, and on most Sundays, church was followed by Sunday dinner, where different configurations of folks would gather around the large table in my grandparents' dining room. They lived on a corner house in one of the black neighborhoods in Chicago called Chatham, with a busy street light just outside of their door and an elementary school right across the street. The traffic and the noise, the busyness was a fullness that was reflected in their home. Smells filled the air each Sunday. My grandmother would start cooking on Saturday afternoons, snapping green beans, rolling dough for rolls, and baking pies. Sounds battled in the waves above us. A deep belly laugh, a kid picking at the piano, grandma yelling to grab more chairs from the basement. And despite granddaddy's stern expectations, not everybody who sat down at the table had come from church that day. From the kiddie table, I could hear the table conversation weave through the morning sermon, concerns from work that week, gossip from what happened at the bar the night before, held together by wisdom and questions and joyful giggles. While reaching across the table to share the entrees of the meal, they reached into the lives of one another with care and concern for what was held and needed. It's not been until my adult years that my own reflection on the complexity of Sunday dinner has really solidified. At that table was the reality of addiction and grief, crises of faith, impacts of under-resourced schools, chaos, domestic distress, the deep needs that we have heard this week from theologians and from cellists. At that table, there was also willingness, presence, memory, harmony, generosity, warm peach cobbler, and joy. It's similar to the broad ways that we have engaged both festival and conference this week with honest wrestling of profound pain and division echoing in our world and our opportunities to respond with presence, innovation, and beauty. This is the complexity of our world. This is the fullness that joins us when everyone gathers at the table. This is how we respond as people who know God. And so these are the layers that I bring to the communion scene of Matthew that Andrew read for us earlier. It's Passover, a Jewish family celebration. There are women who have been cleaning and cooking. The anxiety of the disciples is filling the air. The burden of Judas comes forward quickly, and the hope of Jesus sustains. And there's gratitude and trust and companionship. This is what it means to gather, to commune, to hold expressions of our truths and practice hope. Church historians say that early communion services focused not just on Jesus' death, but more on the friendship that was shared at that table. Early followers gathered, enjoyed a meal together, shared prayers of thanksgiving. They remembered with stories and debate, with laughter and music. And so the words of communion, the scripture of today, these are familiar words from around a full table. First spoken by Jesus to the disciples, then to leaders of the first Jesus communities, and then across centuries now, in cathedrals and park shelters, in Latin and Swahili, sung in liturgy, and remembered in emergency rooms. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said to them, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." And then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he said to them again, saying, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." I grew up in a church where we took communion every Sunday, and sharing a tray of bread and wine that was passed along and taken individually. My first experience with Mennonites meant that I found myself in a circle chosen randomly by where we were seated, and when these unfamiliar spirits gathered around a circle around the bread and the wine, we each broke off a chunk of bread from a shared loaf, saying, "This is my body broken for you." Which was another way of saying to each other, to these people that we didn't really know, "Let's share the journey of God together." Which was really a complicated way of saying, "I love you." I draw us into this communion metaphor to honor all of the ways that we have shared pieces of ourselves with one another this week, maybe just this morning, or maybe in really deep ways throughout this week, parts of our sacred selves. It's been like morsels of bread shared across tables, not just put in hands to be taken, but to be eaten, to be held in our memories. "This is my body," Jesus said, speaking of something beautiful, something sacred, something whole. It's a metaphor, meaning that all the good gets gathered together. "This is my body," Jesus says, speaking of something unpretty and disappointing and broken. It's a reality, meaning all of the parts and pieces which propel us throughout our days. "This is my body," Jesus says, creaky and worn, and yet there she is, that body, heart and lungs, dancing in rhythm, eyes open, ears listening, salty food on my tongue, fingers moving lightly over the keys. "This is my body," Jesus says. Friends, our shared gifts held in community this week have been ordinary and sacred. Across tables of connection, we get to celebrate the divine that is familiar and emerging. This is not just stale ritual. These are holy practices of hope. Theologian and pastor Barbara Brown Taylor reminds us of the importance of the communion gathering by saying, "With all the conceptual truths in the universe at his disposal, Jesus did not give them something to think about together when he was gone. Instead, he gave them concrete things to do, specific ways of being together in their bodies that would go on teaching them what they needed to know when he was no longer around to teach them himself." "Do this," he said, "not believe this, but do this in remembrance of me." So they did. So we did. So we are. And from this place today, we will re-enter a Sunday, a Father's Day, a Juneteenth, in a world where we will re-encounter discord and beauty. The invitation of this past week is to remember the communion called forth by Christ, this place where we are compelled to participate in the work of God, to share these wonders with one another, and to listen for the invitation of bread breaking together. Scooting from our chairs at the table, rising up from our pews, boarding a plane, or clicking X on the YouTube tab is not the end of this meal. With our bellies full and our neighbors engaged, removing our napkin is not the conclusion of our fellowship. It's the beginning. It's the place where we restart our journey with new stories from identities not our own. In this week, we have reached across the table to celebrate each other's gifts, to touch each other's wounds, and be transformed by the Spirit that keeps drawing us together. As Jesus did with the disciples, we have practiced hope. Hope that words from our ancestors will remain a guide. Hope that coming together will always reveal God's goodness. Hope that we find new ways to join in this opus God is conducting. The end of this fellowship is the start of shared beginnings. We begin together the next opus with beauty and inspiration as prophetic tools to know God and one another more deeply. And so we gather, we commune, we practice hope. And at the end of that supper, they sang a hymn and headed toward the mountain out of joy and gratitude, carrying forward the practices that they had shared together. May this be so in our lives.
Let us pray.
together book number 989. What you'll find there are familiar words, again, the prayer that Jesus taught. And in the spirit of the practices that we get to share together in community, I'm gonna invite us to do this in a slightly uncomfortable way. So if you would stand with me, please. The words of the prayer are offered in multiple languages, and I invite you to speak the words of the ones that are on the page or in your heart that are most comfortable. And instead of facing forward here where we have been wonderfully gazed all morning, I'm going to invite you to pivot your body and enjoy the experience of each other in this space. So turn. I know. And take in the beauty of God's community gathered here today. And let's pray these words as we witness one another. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Thank you. benediction, that peace will rise like bread. We can always hope. That justice will flow like wine. We can always hope. That the table will make strangers kin. We can always hope. That our hope will sustain, will rise like bread. We can always pray. Amen.